I think I got my mute on, guys. Sorry. You know, I was wondering if I should do one because I really haven't announced it, but it occurred to me that I really do these videos, or at least I should be doing these videos, basically so I can keep working. I almost thought about doing one or not doing one. I was like, should I do one? Should I not do one? And I thought to myself, I'm doing these so I can keep motivated, not necessarily so I can get tons and tons and tons of viewers or anything like that. That's one thing that I really got wrapped up in the last week. I really got, over the last week and a half, I kind of feel, I don't want to say a depressive state, but I guess that's the best way of putting it. I got too wrapped up in numbers, better, want of a better term, the primacy of numbers, like from Philip Glass's score for No, Not Quite Kotze. I got too wrapped up in numbers, how much it is. You know, who follows, how many people follow, how many people like, when are they liking it, when do they not like it, what do people want? And then it got to be too, I don't want to be something I'm not. And I realized I was trying to become something that was popular rather than what I enjoyed being. And the weight of that just came crashing down on me this week. And I just realized I do art not to get thousands of likes and follows and favorites. I do like art to put one smile on one person's face. That's where I feel like a failure. If I haven't made anybody smile once, then I feel like a failure. If I make one person smile, yeah, it's a lot of hard work. I put in, I was moaning this week about how long it's taken me to work on one page of Alice in Zombieland, when it occurred to me, last week I had the page inked, and it was just raw ink. It was just ink on a page. It was, that was all it was. And not even all of it. And over the last week, I got that page finished. So I got it all done. I'm typing into Facebook, sorry. At my work, I'm talking on the phone and typing at the same time. And I just used to think I should be able to do this a lot easier. But what had happened was, like I said, the weight of just trying to be something I'm not crashing down, and I realized I need to put in lots of work to do put in, give, get a smile from someone. And that's all I really want is a smile, one smile. And just that. It was just, I got so wrapped up in being the guy that was popular, and that was stupid. I don't do these videos to be popular. I do these videos because I want a record of what I'm doing. I want to be, have something, a goal to motivate me to actually get out a page and work on a Friday. If I hadn't done this video, I probably would have sat around and played video games and done nothing. And that's a waste of my time. I mean, I played a lot of video games this week, more than most weeks, because I've been working myself to an exhaustion trying to make myself famous. And that was absolutely stupid. Absolutely waste of my time. Absolutely not who I am. And I just came back to the root of who I am, and you know, it all came crashing down, for want of a better term. And I just realized I was at a place that God didn't want me to be. I was becoming this fame-hungry person, and that was ugly. And I just need to relax and unwind and be who I am. And that's what I'm doing this week, is just being who I am. And one of the things I am is broadcasting these videos, and if no one watches, I know I get people that watch. And people go out and look at the videos afterwards. And I don't want anybody to watch every video for every minute. Gosh, these videos would probably be drastically boring. Non-stop. I mean, for live stream, it's probably not so bad. You tune me in, you listen to me, you laugh because you're listening to it live. But playing it back is probably a bit excruciatingly boring. Live inking my comic now. I was going to be on at like 1:30. It's like 1:45, 1:49 to be exact. Now I'm looking at my laptop computer. And the problem is, it is been a long process to get this all set up, so it took me about 15 minutes. Facebook, oh, I need to do one more thing on Facebook, ECB Press. I used to post this on DeviantArt, but I haven't been on DeviantArt in so long, my computer doesn't like DeviantArt's like scripting. So I have a group, Gotham Girls, unofficial Gotham Girls, UFC Gotham Girls, if you remember that, thank you. If you've submitted art recently to that group and I've ignored it, it's not that you're not good enough, it's because my internet sucks and I can't see you posted something. I've gone back and re-asked people to resubmit, and then they've ignored the request. So if you submitted a request and it got ignored, please resubmit. It's probably because my internet wouldn't let me load the page until it was too, the opportunity to do it had ex to accept your art had been expired. So if you have submitted art to that group on DeviantArt, the unofficial Gotham Girls group, you can tell because I'm the administrator. BauerPower24777 is my name on there, and if you see me on there. And you know, I will like I will I'm not a very heavy I'm not a very heavy-handed administrator. So if I if you're if it says your post was expired, probably meant that I couldn't get internet access to get to load the page to accept stuff. So yeah, don't feel bad. You're not, your work is not substandard or below what my standards are. I try not to have very many high standards. I mean, if it's like pornography, I won't post it on there. But I try not to have too, you know, like very high standards. So if you got ignored, it's because my internet didn't work. Anyway, getting back to the live inking. Oh, neat. My friend just sent me a link for a video I need to see. That's awesome. It's actually going to tie into the video quite nicely. it's going to be awesome. I'll have to tell him. Sorry, I apologize for this. Anyway, so he might get that message and go, oh, crap, I guess I talked about Twitter. Yeah, it's funny because sometimes I'll get messages from my friends when I'm in the middle of these videos, and sometimes they're obscene, intentionally obscene, just so that oh, so that's what I'm talking about. I'll get a message from my friends, and it'll make me laugh, but I just got another one from a friend of mine. But anyway, back to the matter at hand. We're focusing back on art and doing it for what makes me happy, which is making art to make one person happy, even if it's only one person. This is the page I'm working on. Oh, my nerd shirt for the day is my Star Wars shirt, by the way. I've worn it like tons of times. But here it is. This is the page 5 that I did for the comic. And nasty looking rabbit. I cannot wait to get working on him. People are like, are you going to ink that? I'm like, yeah, of course. It's part of the comic. So, yeah, I'm going to ink it. Darn right I am. So I'm going to scoot that up. Get a good view. Okay, good. I got a good view of that. I'm trying to make sure you get a good angle so you can see it. Not right from above because you can't do that on a laptop computer. But you can at least get a good angle where you can see where I'm working because otherwise my big old head gets in the way. Last week I tried out for the first time my fancy Raphael brush, which is normally like a $30 brush that I got for $13 on Amazon. Thank you, Amazon, for cheap purchases for expensive tools. And, of course, I'm using Black Star ink, which is one of my favorites. It's thicker, and it's not runny, which is like the same thing as saying it's thicker. But it's a lot better than – it doesn't give as much glare. I tried another ink before, and it glared a lot. I forget which one it was that it glared a lot, and I'm not trying to call people out on this. But usually when I load my brush, I never go over this stuff anymore, and I should go over it more in detail. Whenever I load the brush, I run it through the ink, and then I twist it to get a nice point on it. This Raphael brush can get a really nice point on it if I can kind of show you how pointy that can get. I'm trying to decide where I want to get started because all the floor tiles here I'm going to do with a ruler to get the tiles straight. Let me just start up here in her face, I guess. Maybe I shouldn't start at a focal point because I'm not warmed up yet. And the other thing is too, I've never inked over this blue pencil. Usually, when I do the comic, I've done it in other cruddy paper, and then scanned it in, and then after the fact, made it blue through Photoshop to ease the removal of the color of the pencil lines. This is the first time I've actually drawn a page in a pencil that was colored blue, because I found them at my local art supplier. And then when you go to Photoshop, you can go ahead and remove the colors, the blue levels, and leave you just the black. Well, you make it black again because it leaves, when you take away the blue, it leaves like an orangish red color. And then you remove the orangish red. I mean, you remove the blue, leave the orangish red, and you turn the orangish red to black, and you're left with just the pencil. And the inking, I mean, the pencils are gone. Yeah, the ink has a hard time going through the pencil, making a nice rich black. The pencil resists it a little bit. But going over it a couple times makes the line blacker, so that's good. I was a little concerned about that. Because you have the same problem when you print it out, too. The printer ink resists the ink when you put it down. So kind of one of those struggles. You have to go over two or three times to get good coverage on it, but that's okay. Let me kind of noodle around for a little while up here. Can you, oops, got my big old head in the way again. Sorry about that, folks. What I'm going to do is... Oops, you can't see that, can you? Nope, there we go. And then... I probably should have put my panel borders in first with a ruler. But I'll be all right, I think. Never thought all those years working at Bed Bath & Beyond would pay off, and then it's like, oh, I know how to draw a curtain. Yay! So all those years of looking at curtains up close paid off. Because now people say, oh, is that how a curtain looks? I'm like, yes, that is how a curtain looks. I saw it all day long. Consider it 10 years of research for moments like this. All these wonderful curtains. The other thing is, too, I'm going to have to turn the page a lot, so if you see me doing that, there's a reason for that. The arm curves naturally as a, you know, like a rainbow. So never fight against that. And I always find it's better to pull the brush away from you than to drag it towards you. Am my hand in the way again? On a side note, I'd really love to get a nice expensive camera and rig it up so you can see it right overhead, but yeah, that's a want, and it's really expensive to do that sort of thing, and this doesn't pay me, so right now you're going to have to make do with a laptop camera and angling the laptop monitor just right. Yeah, this blue, inking over the blue pencil is going to take a little bit of getting used to. I think I'll get used to it because it'll be cheaper than printing it out. It's way cheaper than printing it out. I mean, the printing it on a piece of paper is only a dollar a shot, so it's not an unfeasible amount of money. When you figure you got a comic of 26 pages, that's $26, and that's coming out of, you know, yours truly's budget, which for this comic I might add is zero because I don't make any money off of it. So this is play money. So it's like, you know, go to McDonald's, get a McChicken sandwich, or have a piece of paper printed on. I think I'd rather eat. Of course, I don't eat McDonald's all the time either, but, you know. It's just a lot of money to sink into something that I know I'm not getting any payback for it yet. I mean, I might get paid for this eventually. I mean, I'm going to try to maybe sell issues of it if I can get enough pages together. But therein lies the problem, getting issues to pages together. I mean, it's taking me months to get 4 or 5 pages together. I mean, this is page 5 I'm just working on now. And I've written the entire first issue, but doing the art for this between work and just relaxing and not stressing about stuff takes an incredibly long amount of time to make anything of good quality. Yeah, I mean, I could half care about it. That's the nicest word I can use at the moment. But I don't want to just turn out junk just to get something out there. I want to turn out a decent quality piece of work. There's a fine line, though, between obsessing about every detail and turning out a solid piece of art, and I'm starting to get on that obsession level where I'm like making sure it's the most beautiful piece of art ever, and it's like, it's never going to be. It's a webcomic and 26 pages a shot. It's never going to be the most profound piece of art you've ever seen in your entire life. But at the same time, I still want to maintain a good level of quality. That's the one thing I've realized, that with illustrative art, you almost aren't going to always have flawless illustrations. A cover, you want to make sure a cover is like the best thing you've ever done. But when it comes to interior art, I think a lot of times it suffers because the sheer volume of stuff you need to crank out. I mean, the sheer number of illustrations necessary to pull off an illustrative story like this, even for one issue. I mean, we're talking several small compositions. I mean, on this page alone, 5. And each one has several elements, a background, the characters, all that stuff together, which can all start to add up. All right. Considered whether I want to do this line, I think I do want to do that line there. Just give it a little bit of a neck crease or something. Even if I don't like it, I can always remove it in Photoshop. I was wondering if I want to make this all black, and I think I do. It's all black. It's a little thin on her shoulder. Well, it's not, I was going to say, it's a little thin on her shoulder, but I just realized there's a black panel back there, so that might affect how the rest of the panel goes. Black floor tile's right over her shoulder, so I might have to be careful with that. I'm making her the line weights on her a lot thicker. She's a lot closer to the viewer. And then the rabbit's going to be really kind of tiny because he's further away. I usually favor a very bold line around the outside edge of everything, which is kind of like against everything they tell you in drawing class if you're drawing like art. But with a comic book, it's a lot more graphic, meaning it's the graphic impact, not realism, is essential. And don't get me wrong, there's a lot of artists that are very, very realistic, but there's a lot of fine art that's very decorative that has a heavy outline, mostly Art Deco. Not Art Deco, sorry, Art Nouveau. And with Art Nouveau, it's very much bold outlines and decoration. Adam Hughes' run of Wonder Woman covers, he almost always uses the lasso as some sort of Art Nouveau decorative element. It's like it floats in midair and does loop-de-loos for no reason except for decoration purposes only. And that's, he actually goes into that in his book. He actually talks about it. He actually is like, yeah, at one point I just realized, oh, I can use this as a decorative element instead of a compositional element, and just went to town with and this really loopy, curvy lasso for just to fill space and make up an interesting patterns. So a lot of comic book art does derive a lot of stuff from Art Nouveau, because it was art that was realistic, but also had a big thick outline for decorative purposes only. And helps make a bigger impact when you have a bigger line on some stuff. Alright. Now that I'm a little bit more warmed up, I'm going to go ahead and start inking in here. Eyebrow. There we go. Whoops. I have a whole mess of paper towels that I keep handy just so I can wash the brush out, because the brush gets kind of backed up with ink that just sits in the brush. So I always have a cup of clean water, usually a red Solo cup. So I got my red Solo cup filled with just regular tap water. Oh, and I didn't even get my brush soap out. It's like conditioner shampoo for the, whoops, there we go. So you can see it while I get my chair adjusted again. I mean, they sell this stuff. I bought this one for like $4 at Suburban Paint. Whoops, this is the empty one. In case I need a dish of water and don't want to spill out. Where is my brush soap, my good one? The empty one. Another thing I keep handy too is correction fluid, aka whiteout. because you make mistakes, and I'm missing my brush up. I can't believe it. And then keep that handy. Because I don't know what I was talking about. Oh, it's in my other bag. I forgot. This is my... Jeez. No wonder I don't have the right bag. I have two art bags of Ziplocs. One is just like random stuff I hardly use. The other one's a bag of stuff I use all the time. The bag of stuff I use all the time is right by my chair the whole time. That's where the real brush up is. This is my gallon bag full of stuff I use all the time. My blue pencil, my tape, my erasers. High quality art supply storage right here, folks. Brush soap. See, it's just regular cake, like whitish soap. I'm keeping my brush stuff at a distance. Last time I kind of splashed a bit and made a couple splatter marks on the page. But look how, see how this is white soap. Look how black it got. So there's a lot of ink backed up on this brush. Good thing I cleaned it when I did. There's some stuff I'm gonna have to look into. I heard from, I think it was from artist Terry Moore's page, who was talking about this art gel, I think it's called. You leave it in the brush, it helps reshape it. So I have another inking brush that kind of got old because some of the bristles get flayed off of it. You want it, when the brush is wet, you want all the bristles to kind of come together as a chisel. And over time, some bristles get kind of, they get kind of misbehaving and wind up and sticking out. So you have a bunch of bristles like this, and then one does this. So whenever you ink, you've got like a ghost line on the side, and it makes an ugly line. I've heard that art gel helps you reshape them, even on older ones. I might have to try it, because, I mean, if I can rescue a $15 brush with a bottle of stuff that's like $3, I'll do it. Because my Winsor & Newton still gives me a lot of good lines, but not consistently, and that's the problem. You don't want to have to gamble on whether your tool's going to give you a good results. You have to make sure, you want it to give you a good result every time. I don't want to gamble on whether or not it's going to be a good day. All right. I mean, look at my art supplies here. Paper plate. Paper plate, red Solo cup. I went to Bojangles for lunch. Wow. Really, really living the glory life. No, I'm kidding. I love going to Bojangles every Friday morning. One of the things I look forward to. Oops. There we go. Now I'm trying to decide how to do the curve of her hair. Like, I know how to do it. It's just I'm trying to figure out which way the... Well, I kind of figured it out. Yeah, I load the brush pretty good. Can you? No, you can't see it. It's way off camera. Another thing that's funny too is that the paper has pre-printed lines to help you tell you where the printing would stop in publication. And some of the pre-printed lines like will resist the ink too. And actually the pre-printed lines resist the ink a little bit worse than the blue pencil does, so it's like, oh boy. Oh boy. All right. Oops. This is really starting to get a little bit flayed. It's putting too much pressure on the brush itself. Oh, come on. There we go. I was holding the brush way up at the tip, causing it to kind of flay the bristles out a little bit. There we go. I like talking during these things because I have to sit in silence because YouTube will hit me with a copyright violation if I put music on, and that would be my first choice. And my first video I did put music on very, very softly so that I could hear it, but the audio didn't pick up on it. But the second time I had it a little bit too loud.
and YouTube picked up on it and hit me with a copyright violation, which didn't hurt me at all, except the fact that it muted my audio, so then I lost everything. So if I'm just sitting here talking about, hey, look, if you do this with your art, you do this with the art, and meanwhile, you can't hear it because YouTube muted the entire audio track. So it's gone for all eternity on that first video. And it's like, oh boy. Never again am I going to do that business. But yeah, that's why I don't even risk putting out music anymore, because I could lose it. Let me get one thing real quick. I'm getting getting my page 4 for last time. Because page 4 ties into the bottom of page 5. See, the panel for page 4 is basically, this is the same panel, except we're pulling over her shoulder shot. So I like having this page handy so I can take a look at it and see how I made it look as close as possible to the original one I'm referencing. So basically, we're going to have a big fat close-up of her, and then we're going to kind of pan to an over-shoulder shot in this next page, where we're going to see what's behind her the whole time before going onward with the story. And so we're going to have the white rabbit there, and she's going to go, oh, I hear a sound, turn around. She's going to say, hey, what's that? And it's going to turn around, it's going to be this fanged white rabbit, so it's going to be like, surprise, not what you thought it was going to be. Not a kinder, gentler white rabbit for sure. But a mean, kind of carnivorous white rabbit. I wouldn't say vampiric, so I don't think it eats blood. I don't think it drinks blood. I think it eats stuff. I just see it eating stuff like dead carcasses, carrion, etc. So a wicked, evil white rabbit. Speaking of which, I might go ahead and get started on some of him. Kind of a little shorthand here. Actually, he turned out pretty well so far. Head turned away. When I color, it's going to be a lot easier to tell what it is, but for right now, I can see it if it's hard to tell. Inking in a coat. Kind of hard to figure out how you have a rabbit sit when he's wearing a tail coat. You don't really have a photo reference for that. So I can pull up Google and say, okay, what does a rabbit look like when he's wearing a, you know, like a tailcoat jacket, and he's kind of sitting on the ground. There's really not a photographic reference for that. So I kind of had to make it up. There is a couple, like, hopefully got a little bit of tail there. And yeah, I'm inking some of the stuff that he's going to be like munching on. It's kind of this nasty bone, a little bit of bone here, like he's going to be gnawing on or something. This pile of whatever it is. I'm debating whether I want to do that line down the middle of the coat. I think I will. Yeah, that's nice. Yeah, that doesn't distract the eye. A lot of this other stuff is ruler, except for the... See, I always make an evaluation. What would I do with a ruler? What am I going to do with a circle template? What am I going to do with, you know, the brush? So I'm always trying to figure out what I'm going to do with the brush. I like doing all the brushwork on my days off because I really can't do brushwork very easily at work. And I can do the brushwork very easily at home at my leisure. And then I can do all the curtains, all the characters, anything organic I do with the brush. The floor tiles, that's a little bit more mechanical, so I'll do that with a ruler and a pen. I'm going to turn the page. Yeah, it's still viewable. I'm not, like, trying to be a camera, you know, camera hog or anything, but at the same time, I don't want you to be seeing a video at the top of my head for 2 hours. Well, it's going to have to be a 2-hour video. I'm going to probably only do for like an hour and a half or so today. But I don't want you to be watching the video and having just the top of my head or the corner of my chin or something for the whole video, because that would be stupid. So then you're like, wait, I can hear his voice. I see a brush moving, but I can't see what he's doing. So I'm always consciously trying to pay attention to make sure I'm not blocking anything. Well, that's a good shot. You can actually see the brush working. All these years of painting paid off. I felt so good when I went to I showed my portfolio to a professor that professor at SCAD, who will remain unnamed because I don't want to seem like he's giving me an endorsement. But he looked at my stuff. He says, "Well, you got good solid brushwork." I'm like, "Thanks." I mean, I've never gone to SCAD or anything, but it's nice to know that a SCAD professor thought I could brushwork. But then again, for years I've been painting, I better have good brushwork. You know, all those years I painted in my life. Should be some good, better be some good brushwork. I was handling the brush when some people were handling the basketball, and I suck at dribbling a basketball. I can't do that to save my life, and I wish I knew how to do that better. At the same time, it's nice to know my hard work went somewhere instead of wasted. Oh man, I am mashing down this brush really hard. Hang on, guys. I'm like choking right up on the bristles here. Sometimes I get really tight on what's called the ferrule, F-E-R-U-L-E, which is the metal part, the middle sleeve. I'm getting like working my way up the brush until I'm right up on the metal part. I'm like squeezing the bristles. I need to back off the brush a little bit. I've seen a lot of artists do that though. One of my favorite artists, his name's Marcio Takara. He does all his inking with a really tiny brush, and he's like, wait, right up there on the brush head. So, I mean, you can be back here if you want to, but most artists that are doing finer work will be right up there, right where I'm sitting on my brush right now, which is right at the point of the where that metal sleeve starts. Which the fancy name is the ferrule. I don't know if it's ferrule or ferrule or how it's pronounced, but it's F-E-R-U-L-E. That fancy name for that metal sleeve that holds the bristles in. You don't want to squish that, because if you squish that, that's where all the bristles are, and you could misshape your brush from then on. So I'm kind of like choking on it. I'm like, oh, let me back off a little bit. Before I got started with this video, I made sure I had a good scan of this, because once I start inking it, there's never going to be this page again, because I'm inking with the original pencils, and most of the other pages of Allison Zombieland I've done so far, the pencils were on a separate page, except for page one. I traced the entire thing onto an original sheet of paper, but page two was a printout, page three was a printout, so there's the original pencils of that still exist. And depending on the art, in the comic world, sometimes the pencils still exist, sometimes they don't. What happens these days is most artists, the pencilers, they pencil the work. While they're hard at work on the next page, the inker gets like a digital copy, who he then prints out in blue pencil to resemble whatever I have here, and then inks over the copy that he has. So the penciler retains his original art, the inker retains his original art, scans that, sends that to the colorist, who then colors the page in. Back in the old days, though, before scanning was really cheap, you would have pencilers that would send their original pencil sketches to the inker, who would then ink over the original pencils, and they're lost for all time. It still happens, though, because Terry Dodson, who's one of my other favorite artists, his wife is his inker, so he doesn't scan it, submit it to anybody. He just goes, "Here, honey." She inks it, and then the original pencils are gone. So if he doesn't scan the pencils before she gets to work, his pencils are gone for eternity. In fact, if you do a Google search for Terry Dodson pencils for interiors, you'll probably find three pages. And he's done interiors for X-Men,
a Harley Quinn series, a whole bunch of stuff. But you won't find any pencils because, like I said, as soon as he's done with the pencils, he hands them to his wife, and she inks on top of them, erases out the pencil lines, and boom, they're gone. That's basically that page done. I'm wondering if I should do her eye with the brush or not. I think I will. Now that I'm warmed up, I'm not worried about semicircles. I can do it.